Welcome back to another message from the Little Church World. If this is your first time, we are very excited that you've joined us, and we want to give you a special welcome. We urge you to spend the next 20 or so minutes with us as we explore some special topics and wisdom from the God's Word spoken by our leaders here at the Little Church World.
Hello and welcome to the second of the TLC World Series entitled Defining Moments. In this series, we're looking at decisions, actions, and events reported in the Bible that have had significant effects going way beyond the decisions, actions, and events themselves. One such defining moment is the encounter Moses has with God in the burning bush. Now, this encounter is described in Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 to 6. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the far side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in flames of fire from within a bush. Moses saw that though the bush was on fire, it did not burn up. So Moses thought, I will go over and see this strange sight, why the bush does not burn up. When the Lord saw that he had gone over to look, God called to him from within the bush, Moses, Moses. And Moses said, Here I am. Do not come any closer, God said. Take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground. Then he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. At this, Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look at God. Despite much reluctance on the part of Moses, the outcome of the burning bush meeting is that God anoints Moses as his earthly representative in order to rescue the Israelite people from slavery under the yoke of the Egyptians. Moses is given the awesome task of confronting the most powerful man on earth at the time, the Pharaoh of Egypt, in order to compel him to free the Israelites from his grasp. The story of how Moses does this, which involves him calling down 10 plagues in Egypt, described in the book of Exodus chapter 7 through 12, along with how he subsequently leads the Israelites to the Promised Land, is one of the most well-known in the Bible. The Hollywood blockbuster of the late 1950s called The Ten Commandments, and the later 1990s cartoon version of the story, namely The Prince of Egypt, are both still widely watched today. It's fair to say that Moses is the most significant character in the Old Testament. His encounter with God in the burning bush event is a defining moment in the Bible because it's the beginning of a relationship with God and a life of service to him, as recorded in Deuteronomy 34, verses 10 to 12. No prophet has arisen in Israel like Moses, whom the Lord knew face to face, who did all those signs and wonders the Lord sent him to do in Egypt, to Pharaoh and to all his officials and to his whole land. For no one has ever shown the mighty power or performed the awesome deeds that Moses did in the sight of all Israel. Following the burning bush meeting, the influence of Moses as a person anointed by God and as a symbol of God's working in human affairs is profound in terms of the Christian faith. Moses was one of the major authors of the Old Testament. The first five books of the Bible, collectively known as the Pentateuch, were written by him. This includes the book of Genesis, which describes both the creation of the world by God and the fall of man, which was the theme of last week's message. Of course, there are skeptics who argue against Moses as the author of these five books. However, there are very solid reasons for accepting that Moses was, in fact, the author. Dealing with skeptics' arguments could be a message in itself, but for the purpose of today, I want to point out just a few of the reasons why we can be confident that Moses authored the five books. Firstly, in no less than 10 separate passages in the Old Testament, Moses is confirmed as the author. His authorship is reconfirmed in the New Testament in 14 further passages, including statements made by Jesus Christ himself. One example is when the Sadducees, who did not believe in the resurrection, tested Jesus on the conditions of marriage in the afterlife. His reply is recorded in Mark 12, verses 24 to 26. Jesus replied, "Are you not in error because you do not know the scriptures or the power of God? When the dead rise, they will neither marry nor be given in marriage. They will be like the angels in heaven." Now about the dead rising, have you not read in the book of Moses, in the account of the burning bush, how God said to him, "I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob"? One common approach of the skeptics is to start from a position of ruling out the possibility that Moses wrote the Pentateuch and to look for other explanations as to how it came to be written. They generally ignore references to the numerous references to Moses as its author in the Bible. Nevertheless, the case for Moses as the author of Genesis through to Deuteronomy is very strong and is summarized by Bodie Hodge and Dr. Terry Mortensen, writing for Answers in Genesis, as follows. Not only is there abundant biblical witness that Moses wrote the Pentateuch, Moses was fully qualified to write the Pentateuch. He received an Egyptian royal education and was an eyewitness to the events recorded in Exodus to Deuteronomy, which contain many references or allusions to Egyptian names of places, people, and gods, as well as Egyptian words, idioms, and cultural factors. And as a prophet of God, he was the appropriate recipient of the written records or oral traditions of the patriarchs from Adam to his own day, which the Holy Spirit could use to guide Moses to write the inerrant text of Genesis. There is no other ancient Hebrew who was more qualified than Moses to write the Pentateuch. However, from a Christian viewpoint, the most powerful evidence of Moses' authorship of the Pentateuch is the very fact that Jesus Christ himself, the creator of the universe, the source of Moses' authorship, confirmed him to be the author. At the center of Moses' Bible authorship is the law that governed relations between the Israelite nation as a whole and God, and between individual Israelites. The most quoted aspect of the law is the Ten Commandments delivered by God to Moses on Mount Sinai, although the law of Moses actually consisted of 613 commandments. The law is one of the most significant aspects of biblical theology. The law was there to provide a blueprint or guide to moral and ethical living approved by God. It also served to demonstrate that the moral standards contained in these 613 commandments are impossible to achieve by man in his own power. Israelite history demonstrates this fact because it's littered with temporary obedience followed by disobedience, then repentance and restoration. This pattern was repeated time and time again as God interacted with the Israelites. The Israelites were not unique in their disobedience, but merely displaying the common human condition that applies when there is a need to follow externally imposed rules that are not heartfelt. As God's chosen instrument to convey the law, Moses was also pointing the way to Christ, who was to become the means of enabling the requirements of the law to be achieved through placing our faith and trust in him. In Jeremiah 31, verse 33, God states, "I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts." Faith in Jesus Christ, the only one who was able to fully comply with the law, is the means by which the law is written on our hearts. From a Christian standpoint, as we progress in our Christian walk, we become more Christ-like and progressively adopt his moral code as it becomes written on our hearts. Faith in Christ is the one and only way of meeting God's moral requirements, and Moses' authorship of the law made this clear. Moses was also the first servant leader. The central characteristics of servant leaders are that they display humility, they are self-sacrificial, and they're courageous. Regarding his humility, in Numbers 12 verse 3 we read that Moses was very humble, more humble than any other person on earth. Was Moses self-sacrificial? Most definitely. In Exodus 32 verses 30 to 34 we read, "The next day Moses said to the people, 'You have committed a great sin, but now I will go up to the Lord, perhaps I can make atonement for your sin.' So Moses went back to the Lord and said, 'Oh, what a great sin these people have committed. They have made themselves gods of gold. But now, please forgive their sin. But if not, then blot me out of the book you have written.'" The courage of Moses cannot be doubted either. Despite his initial hesitancy in his interchange with God during the burning bush meeting. Repeatedly, Moses confronted the most powerful man on earth at the time, Pharaoh of Egypt, requesting and later demanding that he free the Israelites from his, Pharaoh's, yoke of slavery. And he persisted until Pharaoh was forced to free the Israelites after Moses called down the 10 plagues on Egypt. Moses displayed amazing courage and faith in the Lord in undertaking this daunting task. All in all, Moses displayed all the characteristics of a servant leader in abundance. From a Christian viewpoint, the servant leadership of Moses foreshadows and anticipates the ultimate servant leader, Jesus Christ. The call of Moses in the burning bush event clearly demonstrates that God's will is not constrained by the things of the world. Moses was 80 years old when called by God to be the instrument of his deliverance of the Israelites from the Egyptians. From a worldly perspective, this seems to be far too old to take on such a daunting venture. And yet, not only did God use Moses mightily for this task, he kept him in prime condition to enable him to see the task through to the point of entry of the Israelites to the Promised Land. So we read in Deuteronomy 34 verse 7, "Moses was 120 years old when he died. His eye was undimmed and his vigor unabated." In the same way, God required no prerequisite skills from Moses. It was apparent that Moses felt totally unprepared for the task set before him by God, even referring to some form of speech impediment as an excuse to avoid carrying out the task. We need to keep in view the words of Jesus Christ, God in human form, when he addressed his disciples in this way, "You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, and so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you." And that's from John 15, verses 15 to 16. There's a message here for all believers. When God calls you for a task he has for you, age is not a factor and neither is skill level for the task to be performed. God does not look at your CV. Rather, he gives you all you need for his purposes. In his relationship with Moses, God demonstrated his nature, which is a perfect blend of love and justice. God's view of Moses is clear when he rebukes Aaron and Miriam for speaking against him. In Numbers 12 verses 5 to 8 we read, "Then the Lord came down in a pillar of cloud. He stood at the entrance to the tent and summoned Aaron and Miriam. When the two of them stepped forward, he said, 'Listen to my words. When there is a prophet amongst you, I, the Lord, reveal myself to them in visions. I speak to them in dreams. But this is not true of my servant Moses. He is faithful in all my house. With him I speak face to face, clearly and not in riddles. He sees the form of the Lord. Why then were you not afraid to speak against my servant Moses?'" Now these words reveal deep caring on the part of God for Moses. Nevertheless, we read later at Kadesh that when instructed by God to strike a rock to bring out water for the complaining Israelites, Moses and Aaron failed to give God credit for this miracle. And this is God's reaction. Because you did not trust in me enough to honor me as holy in the sight of the Israelites, you will not bring this community into the land I give them. And that's from Numbers 20, verse 12. Christ's followers must never think that God sacrifices standards of obedience and righteousness in favor of love. He is not an anything goes God. God's relationship with Moses provides the example of the balance between his two main characteristics of love and justice. Moses and the burning bush is one of the most defining moments in the Bible. This incident represents the beginning of a lifelong relationship between Moses and his Lord that is seldom matched in the Bible until the coming of Christ in the New Testament. Jesus, of course, then paves the way for us to also have an intimate relationship with God. There is much in Moses' life and call to service that provides lessons for Christ followers. So I really suggest that you read his story in the Bible, especially in the book of Exodus, with this in mind. However, if you're not yet a believer and this message is spoken to you in a way that draws your attention, please discuss it with a Christian you know and trust to find out more about the Christian faith. But if there is no one with whom you can discuss the message, please don't hesitate to email me at goodnews@thelittlechurchworld.org, for I'll be more than happy to discuss it with you. So that's it for this week. Please join me next week for another In the Defining Moment series. Until then, God bless you and have a good week.
Well, this concludes another message from the Little Church World. I hope that this message has touched and blessed you in a special way. And again, I urge that you would reach out to some fellow Christian friends or family members and discuss this topic this week. If you have no one like this in your life, feel free to reach out to us at goodnews@thelittlechurchworld.org, and we would be more than happy to connect with you. Thank you.